Okay, the VAT issue is yet to abate. It's still dominating media spaces in Nigeria, and it's also leading to so many questions. One of them is, will it lead to true federalism in Nigeria? Of course, if you look at the papers this morning, a whole lot of issues. In fact, the Tribune did a special on it, with VAT dispute, 11 issues on federalism resurface. We have two gentlemen in the studio who are competent to discuss this issue, and they're here. We have in the next 55 minutes looking at this issue. I have on my immediate right, Mr. Adelia Udo, is a seasoned journalist and broadcaster. He's with us this morning. Mr. Udo, good morning.
Nigeria, thank you.
Thank you so much
for having me. I'm really happy, elated on a personal note. I'm seeing this senior after almost 2 years. She's one of my pride. I introduced her, God used me, and one of those God used to introduce her to the media.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm happy seeing her radiating, Chairman.
We thank you to that your training has reflected in her, and that's why OGTV had to go poach.
She's a material, I know that. Yes.
Okay, joining Mr. Edo this morning is another, you know, popular public analyst, Ustaz Jibril Lawal. It's been a long while he came here, and we decided to bring him out of his tight schedule this morning to discuss this topic. Ustaz, good morning.
Good morning, Biodun. And once again, let me tell viewers that you always hijack me anything you want to. I got hijacked again.
Thank you so much for this selfless service to the country. Now, let's start with Mr. Odo. The VAT controversy has been raging. And if you see the papers this morning, none of the papers this morning has not reported this matter. But it's bringing back the issue of federalism. It looks like the war that Wike started is going to be won in the long run. Now, some issues are coming up. Would this open further discussions on whether Nigeria can actually practice true federalism?
I hope so. I hope this is a divine intervention. I hope this is the beginning of the much talked about revolution, not the street protest revolution or arm-carrying revolution that may eventually give us restructuring or true federalism. However, having said that, I'm also not pleased with my immediate constituency, the media, the way we handle many of these national issues in recent times. Yes. We are supposed to be an ombudsman. We are supposed to be in between the public and the government. And our only assignment is to reflect, do the analysis genuinely and truly as it is. But nowadays, what we find that a lot of us, we've joined them to moan. We've joined people to do analysis and write-ups on sentiment and emotions, not actually laying down the exact situation of things. You just said the Wike started the war. Well, maybe not. You give it to Wike, but I'm not particularly confident about the honesty with Wike. I'm not a tax expert, but as a journalist, you know, I have a little idea over everything. I know that the Lagos State government went to court about 11 times between 2003 and 2006 over many of these issues. But at that time, because that government was the only standing government from the opposition party, not a PDP government, so a lot of the governors did not do anything. I imagine if many of them have taken up that fight then, we will have gone beyond this. Today, I doubt if, Sanwo-Olu or Lagos State government is joining, because like I said, they actually started it. I doubt if Wike is in APC or the ruling government, if we'll have exerted the kind of energy he is about this. I'm going to be looking at this from a social political angle. I also wish and advise, I'll be happy if I see Wike and all the other governors exerting the same pressure into releasing their own powers to local governments. Mm. That's what I talk about, I hope, is the true restructuring. I hope the eventually whatever the Supreme Court says, which will now become the grand norm, will also be practiced. Let it get down to the last tier of government. Let local government be permitted to collect money from the motor parks. Let them be permitted to collect money from signages, signboards, billboards, and all these things. Let them be permitted to do what they want to do or they can do as it regards their environment. This will help them get money. This will help them, at least, if they cannot tar, will be able to grade their own roads. And then the people, Nigerians, can begin to enjoy it. I'm not excited whether it is Wike or the government are fighting another government, because I know a lot of politicking is involved. The genuity, as far as I'm concerned, I doubt it. So that's why I'm not going to attribute this to anything. I know I'm an incurable optimist. I'm a Nigerian. I believe in Nigeria. I want a united Nigeria. God never created any nation that is mono. But unfortunately, like I said, the media, all our discussions, look at many of these discussions. Those who are for, majorly, are from the south. Those who are against are from the north. And that's how we do our national debate. And the media help them to propagate this nonsensical idea of saying we do not turn ourselves to right activists. No. Media reporter can never be a right activist. You report the exact thing. That's why I oppose people when they say fake news. If it's news, it can never be fake by the definition and practice of news. That's my question.
Well, okay. Now, you do has struck the right chord. You know, at governors, if VAT's controversy would truly or is leading us or is setting example for us of how, you know, we should actually run true federalism in this country. Now, are the governors also going to be willing enough, you know, to let this trickle down to the way they run their states? That's the point he has made. Would they also be willing to devolve powers and allow local governments also run their affairs by themselves?
Oh, no, thank you so much. I was listening to him, and I saw that he has some bitterness against members of his club.
You are not doing well.
Well, anyway, I don't want to go too deep into that. I'm not a member of that club, but as a person that benefits from that club, I would say the journalists and the media presently might not have a better choice. They need to report what is happening. They cannot come and bring about their own news. They will report what A said and what B said. And if you look at a lot of major papers, in their opinion, they've always tried to balance their opinion. Guardian, Nation, you just mentioned Tribune, in their opinion column, which is what they can be held responsible for anyway. But being that as it may, you are in that club, you know how to go about doing your job. Back to the issue of, restructuring federalism. I think we're not being honest in Nigeria. Generally, I'm coming to the issue of local government, you know, what governors are doing or not doing for local government. A lot of things are wrong with that local government issue in Nigeria. A lot of things are wrong with them, including how, you know, people are elected into office with local government. I am believing that if you are talking of three tiers of government, we are talking of, you know, the federal government, the state, and the local government. I don't know why state should be given the duty of conducting election into local government offices. I am thinking that's one area we might need to look into. As long as the election, the power to select whoever comes to local government offices is still, you know, resident in the governors, I doubt if any, you know, meaningful change will come into that. What I'll come to that. Let me take the issue of federalism and restructuring. People are not being honest. How do I mean? When you look at the word structure, you can't have a federalism without having a structure. Federalism means a lot of structures have come together, you know. And like you earlier observed, let me call it key into that. The way God has created the universe, there is what you call biodiversity. Biodiversity simply means that The world cannot be mono. We need that diversity in everything that we do, you know, for us to get the best out of it. So I have never been an apostle of Nigeria must break. And I doubt if people that are currently calling for secession were initially asking for Nigeria to break. I equally doubt if what they are asking for now is Nigeria should break. I think what has happened is that somebody somewhere has not listened to the yearnings of the people. Structure means two, three things coming together, organized, arranged in a particular way, you know, to form, you know, a coordinating unit. That's what we call structure. So when we now talk of restructuring, it means rearranging. It means reorganizing. I doubt if restructuring means tear it apart. I'll give an example. If you go to the bank for a loan and you sit down to have an agreement about how your loans will go with your bank, you know, suddenly you can't pay or you have issues with your repaying power, what you do is you go back to your bank. Then they will restructure the loan for you. Okay, we said 30 months before, pay this way, your interest is this. What follows is that they will sit down to discuss. They will sit down to negotiate. That will lead to the restructuring. I don't know whether you are following that logic.
Yes, yeah.
What is missing now is that the people, you know, in Nigeria, some powers, because they are benefiting from the lopsidedness of the structure we have in Nigeria, are not allowing for negotiation, for people to sit down and restructure. And that is where our problem comes from. Let me take from that. There is nothing wrong with Nigeria. Now, what is wrong is that people that are there now, because they are benefiting, are not willing to sit down for us to negotiate, to rediscuss. Okay, this has worked well. This hasn't worked well. Can we review them? That's what I think is all about. Now, on the issue of VAT, what the proponent of let's have a new Nigeria discovered is that, okay, if we cannot, you know, get what we wanted through negotiation, can we revisit the law and let's see what the law will do for us? Like Ayodo rightly observed too, Lagos State didn't just start that war today. Don't forget Lagos State government and President Obasanjo regarding local government, etc. In fact, when the present VP was the Attorney General of Lagos, there were a lot of tremendous, you know, rulings that he was able to get because he took up the constitution and went into court. Let us see how law can help us. So what we are discovering now is that law, the constitution, might not be casted in stone against federalism as we are thinking. There are a lot of contradictions in the constitution anyway. The constitution said we are in a federal state, a federation. They went on to start talking about state that is, you know, centered, you know, to one federal power. So there are a lot of, but even looking at the constitution, people have seen that a lot of loopholes they could explore that could give us that federalism we are looking for. Local government too will get to that level. For now, it is not, because the state government that could have done that are benefiting. When suddenly, somewhere, somehow, at the federal level, the government will start going to court to get injunctions that will bring us, you know, to a new level of having federalism. So if you ask me, the VAT idea is a good one for us. It's coming good well. There are several other things that will come in that will help us to, you know, teeter towards that federalism that all of us are clamoring for. And I think we are just starting.
All right. With your analysis, it is evident that there are issues we definitely need to resolve. And of course, this VAT controversy is bringing us closer to the rediscussion about restructuring, which we've been clamoring for. A lot of Nigerians are really clamoring for that. And it dominated the dailies, you know, last year, early this year. And it seems it's not going to happen. And with the VAT controversy, like you've said, it's one thing that people are really been optimistic with. So for that reason, and for the concerns that you have shared, that the government, especially the state government, that are really interested in getting their own fair share of what Nigeria is of as of now, by way of getting the VAT, you know, getting what the a fair share of what they earn in their state and what they were able to gather. The local government, they are also clamoring for almost the same thing. Do you see this as something that, in the end, you know, if eventually the state government or the state governors eventually win this war, is this something that would force the federal government to also look into the direction of the local government? Of course, they've signed, the president signed executive order 10 to also ensure that the local government get there. Is this going to force that decision to go all out for the state government, you know, to also do the needful when it comes to the local government?
There are two things involved in your question, let me put it that way. The first one is, how do we get, you know, the state government to bow to what Nigerians are yearning for, which is independent local government? Yeah, that is one. The other one is the issue of VAT. When the issue of VAT started raging, in fact, the first time the court in Port Harcourt, the judge in Port Harcourt gave that judgment, what I did was quickly go down memory lane and I did some, you know, I Googled and went for several other judgments that have come in the past, like I said. But then it was on sales tax, etc., you know, for which. Then suddenly I stumbled on, you know, the Ijewere report, the ICAN president there. And before it became, you know, everywhere, Arise News brought him, and I stumbled on his report. And I realized that ab initio, what we have with VAT now was not the intention and the plan of people that brought about VAT. It was not their intention. It was because they wanted to bring about sanity into our tax laws. And they brought out experts who eventually, even from that report that I read, traveled all over the world to see and get the best practice. Now, they realize that for us to get a good tax system, mostly with the VAT, that the power to collect should reside in a central government, you know, in our situation, the federal government. And that once that is collected, then it can be distributed to the state. And what was their intention? Their intent was to protect the taxpayer and Nigerians. But somewhere along the line, that thing got hijacked by the powers that be. And they realized that, look, there's a lot of money in this. We can't allow this state to keep on having this money. And that was why the FARC eventually had to come in, you know, all those ones came in. And if you look at the constitution, in fact, one thing that gave a lot of people the hope that people that are fighting, the state that are fighting for collecting VAT, might eventually have it at the end of the day, is that there is nowhere in Nigerian constitution where it is stated that VAT should be the duty of federal government. So you understand.
Okay.
Some of us initially felt Supreme Court might not go that way, but when after studying, you realize that this is how this thing might eventually fall. But then a lot of other things will come up. In a federation, how do we go ahead with other states? A lot of things will come up. When I'm sure a lot of things will come up. Nigerians need to sit down and discuss even VAT, how do we go about it? On the issue of the local government, yes, what I'm expecting that we have now that will bring about a change is that we should have a strong civil society.
Okay.
That is what we need now. Look at what SERAP is doing now. SERAP is taking federal government to court over the issue of borrowing. I am expecting something like that from other civil society practitioners. You know, being able to stand up and say, no, this must change. And, you know, taking the state government to court, let us test this in the law, let's get court judgment and let's see whether the state governors will not comply with such. So we might need a strong civil society to be able to, yes, to be able to get a new narrative, a new future, as long as, you know, local government independence is concerned.
Okay, Mr. Ayodo, you earlier mentioned, you know, your optimism, especially with this the new dimension with which the conversation is going, and of course you invariably indicted the media as to not doing what we ought to be doing, and of course, and they become writers for politicians and all that. Are you actually surprised that that is what is coming out at this critical stage with a whole lot of issues that has permeated our space, especially with different reports coming in from different angles, how it is being practiced as of now?
Sorry, it surprised about the practice, the reportage.
The reportage.
Well, I'm not surprised. Because of course, that's my field for over 30 years. So I've been watching the systemic rot. I'm only disappointed that those who are supposed to drift it, take the drift, are not doing so. It's a delight when you sit with Ustaz Lawal. He's a resourceful person. But just like he's agreed that that's my field. We know the way we do it. For instance, in the days of Gani Fawemi, we say Gani Fawemi versus Babangida. Then Abacha case is Keyamo versus Kano. So if you want something to hit Babangida to criticize government, just go to Gani Fawemi, you are sure. That's the way we do, and that's what you are sure that he's going to blast Babangida. He's going to move away from whatever Babangida has said. So that's what happened. So a lot of people who they have their own idea. Like I said, check the preponderance of these comments. Again, I go back to news is news. You can have fake information. But as an editor, if you go by tenets what news should be, it can never be fake. So Stas is right in that manner. So we are, but the analysis and the comment, but the way it is introduced is what I said. So you have identified who you are going to see. If you want somebody who wants to talk in favor of the bandits, you go and meet Gumi. And in those days too, we have Cardinal Okoye, and I don't know if they are related. I think they are Shehi Gumi. So that's the way it goes as a reporter. So if you want somebody to hit the other religion, you go and meet Okoye. And then you go to Gumi, it's sure. That's the position. So that's what we are seeing. Like I said, if you see the stand people are taking, it's already the north versus the south. It's sweet. When Wike came out and gave us the figure analysis of how much they are taking away from him, he didn't talk about how much they are taking away from Ebonyi and how much Ebonyi is receiving. He didn't talk about how much they are taking away from Ekiti and how much Ekiti, and our people are also not looking at it. My bitterness, my worry is what I'm saying. We should endeavor that we feed our people. But because Nigeria, my opinion, there are facts too, is in a very fragile state. We have never been in this disjointed situation before, at least in my almost 60 years of existence. So that's why those of us who have the opportunity, it's better to have a strong Nigeria. That's why I refer to that issue when Lagos State, and like I said, the current vice president, was fighting this battle. It was party versus party. Again, like I said, I doubt if Wike is a member of the governing party. If he would do that, it's convenient for Lagos because it's what they've started and it pays them more than any other person. You understand? The local government election is like, Wike organized a local government election. He did not vote because he was sure of the result and he cleared everything. That can never be possible. It can never, if you say it's a local government, at least a council seat. You understand? So that's my worry about my people. Let us, at this point, analyze it. Yes, for instance, if you look at what is on ground about this VAT distribution, they say 20% derivation, 50% equity, 30% population.
Yes.
Why are we not explaining this to people? I know there is a social moral problem in this issue of VAT. But why are we not bringing why that is so? Why are we not helping Kano State to let them know that you cannot continue to destroy it used to be sales tax until the Gewe and Babangida? Why you cannot continue to do all those things and feel happy that you are collecting money? You understand? It should be a free society in Kano. The people of Kano, the people of Sokoto should be able to let them have their own opinion. Of course, play by what the law and the rule says. Even in the south here, in Lagos, if you overdrink and get drunk and misbehave in the public, the law has a way of handling it. You know the implication. But if you want to drink, why should I stop you from drinking? in as much as you drink responsibly. You understand? That's what I expect our people to say. It's not every state that will benefit from it. And it's not every state that is losing from this battle. Even though I strongly, he has explained what restructuring. That's the best way for Nigeria to move forward. That's why I stand with restructuring. It's not about confab, convention, whether sovereign or insovereign, whatever it is. But it's about those areas that are decayed. When the government of Babangida in the early 90s, decided to change sales tax to VAT, it was a good intention.
Yes.
But because typical of our system, the structure is weak, anybody who comes with the law does not monitor it, those who are to implement it, even those of us who are to consume it, except it did not favor us. Once it favors us, we take it, just like we are doing with the argument of Wike. Why are we not pressurizing? Yes, it's the beginning, like I see. Why not now use that opportunity to pressurize them too? Do the needful as a government so that Nigeria can work.
So this issue of VAT controversy, is it this frenzy because it suits the governor? What do I do?
That's what I'm saying, honestly. That's what I'm saying. That's why Kasina
will criticize it.
No, honestly, that's why Kasina will criticize it and say, no, we don't want states to collect VAT. That's why Ogun will support and say we must collect VAT. Look at the issue of pastorality. It's the same case. It's because it's Susuke. And then it started by whipping that emotion, coming out with the figure.
So let's also look at another dimension to the story of VAT. And of course, ahead of 2023, a lot of things are happening presently. And some have said that the politics has started and the game of 2023, who and where this zoning, if that is what they've been using, this a gentleman agreement that is being called, that it should come to the South. And recently you saw the southern governors, they came together again and they talked about the need for an agreement. You know, they came for open grazing, they came together to do that. And now on that, they're also coming together to speak in one voice, presumably to send a message to the northerners, those in the north, that this is our stand. And of course, they also, you saw the dailies this morning, one was talking about South might not even get the ticket when it comes to 2023. So are we saying that, like he has said, that the different interests of the different groups coming to play, he said he has not seen the genuineness of they actually speaking directly to the issue of that, but indirectly doing something bigger than that of that, which is that of 2023. Do you see it like that?
Thank you with that question, because you are gradually taking us to what is the crux of the matter.
Mm.
I'm happy about that. When he was responding to your question and Abiodun's question, he mentioned certain things. Let me use the word maybe socio-economy of all this conversation. I know that at the end of the day, we might need to get to the center or to the point where we need to be a border keeper in inverted commerce regarding VAT. But you see, what suddenly brought about all these agitations, like he equally said, we got to a point in Nigeria where, you know, there's so much agitation, you know, coming from people, which normally when things happen, people don't ask questions in the past. 20 years ago, nobody asked question about what, who is doing what. But suddenly, people are becoming aware that some powers that be in Nigeria are the ones benefiting from the structure we currently have. Don't forget how Niger Delta issue started. Niger Delta issue didn't start with, well, it was negotiation, Ken Saro-Wiwa, until he and the Ogoni Nine, don't forget that story, you know, where what do you call it, executed, you understand. Then the boys who had all along been, you know, telling Saro-Wiwa that, look, these people will not listen to negotiation. But Saro-Wiwa was like, no, let's discuss, let's go to round table. So when eventually he was executed, there was judgment came, a lot of people felt
Abacha will not kill them. In fact, when eventually they were killed, we're shocked because so many Nigerians, meaningful Nigerians, went to him, don't kill these people. It will give us a lot of visuals. I remembered, what's his name? Our own, you know, prof here, Shoyika WS, went with some. In fact, it was the day they went that those people were killed. So that was what started, and they now took to the creeks, you know, brought in arms, etc. So questions we are being asked. Our area kept on being degraded, and some part of the country kept on having the best of it. So questions were being asked. Nobody was ready to listen to them. That was how this thing started. Eventually, when this regime came up, with a lot of rumor, a lot of, you know, information and insinuations regarding the current president personality, his statement have not helped us in managing our diversity very well, and which enraged a lot of people. I listened to Dr. Abdulhakeem, the PR, the publishing officer of Northern Elders Forum, and I felt that those statements were not the kind of ones that should have been made in the situation we find ourselves now. It is not. I was expecting that they will come with, you know, discussion, because when the Southern government spoke, they hinged their request on two things: equity and fairness. And I asked the question, if people are Nigerians, don't they have right to become president? Now, but if you are saying that because you have a large number, and because the number is yours, you feel you keep on being there, they are equally saying, okay, fine, the money that is sustaining you comes from us, so we are taking it. That's the kind of thing we are having now. Okay. So I think we need to bring about, you know, someone needs to come, no, these conversations we are having is not going to help our country. And like you have observed, 2023 is in focus, and everybody, the politicians as usual, don't love citizens, they are selfish. So a number of the utterances we are having is not because they love Nigerians, it's because some of them are conversing for themselves. So these are the issues. So I believe, like you have said too, that, you know, leaders of thought in Nigeria should come together and ask all of them to cease all these utterances. Can we come and have a discussion towards how to make Nigeria to work? So I think these are the issues. So somebody soon needs to come in and mediate, if that is the word. The statement of the president saying that we're going to open up old grazing route, you know, felt on negative part of the people that, no, this is not how this thing should have gone. So these are the issues that we have here and there that is bringing the crossfire. Somebody needs to come in and say, can we cease fire? The Absalami of this world, like they try to do, can we bring these people together and say, no, stop these utterances here and there? Can we come in and have some middle course discussion? And I think that is the way to go.
But why their silence, Mr. Edo? You would have really expected Abdul Salami to speak,
yes.
Obasanjo to talk, maybe from the south, or southeast. No one in that class is talking at the moment. Why is everybody keeping quiet? Why is the other statement keeping quiet?
Even notice what happened at the Southern Governors Forum. A number of the eastern states did not show. Those that came their deputy governor. So these are the issues. These are the decisions that I'm talking about towards 2023. They are now protecting themselves. Whatever promises they have from the central government about what they want to give, I don't know. But that is what is playing out now.
The silence of do you hear Abu Salami, you know, talk these days, Danjuma, Obasanjo, and the rest in that class?
Well, that's true. I don't pretend, particularly when I'm in a public space like this. The Yoruba have even said that you're a medium padanuro. So even if I want to pretend, I know that I'm pretend. And I don't think anybody who is sincere with himself will disagree with me that we've never, as a nation, been in this bad situation before. We are in a bad situation in terms of moving forward, in terms of our trust in each other, in terms of our unity, in terms of our belief, and then in the project Nigeria, they say, and the people talk about the security, the newness of it. So it's a real bad situation. So that's why it will be good, it will have been good, if these names you've mentioned come out also. But Can we say those names themselves do not have a position? Can we say those names themselves do not have personal
biases,
obscene bias and interest? I think the answer is no, we can't say that. So that's why how many people will still trust Obasanjo to mediate, unlike who he was before he became civilian president, and immediately, if you look at his movements and role,
the trajectory
between 2014 and 2015 and today. How many Nigerians, I don't want to say a lot of things here, because many of them, you know, there's a difference between truth and fact.
Okay.
It's the truth. But because I can't bring out the empirical proof visible, so it cannot be the fact. How many Nigerians really trust Abu Salami? You know how many times they've coined his name into what we are witnessing in the North, East, and Northwest? How many Nigerians trust him? You understand? So that's the depth of the decay in our structure. And that's why somebody like me, I'm very, very optimistic of a divine intervention, which I have seen. The person who is going to bring about, straighten it, will even think he's fighting a personal war or a war against Nigeria, but he has actually starting the real revolution. I'm awaiting what the Supreme Court judgment will be on this issue. And I tell you, Biodun, note it. It will begin, a lot of things will come out as offshoots.
Yes.
Okay,
from this VAT journey.
Okay, let's also look at the narratives, you know, in different parts of the country. We in the South, we often believe that the North has the advantage over any other persons, any other region.
In terms of population, don't let us deceive ourselves.
the population is a big one. And some people have said that it is actually not precisely the North in general. It is a matter of the elite, you know, from the South and from the North, because of the indices of the different, you know, atrocities that is being that's taking place in the North at the moment. We talk about education, access to education. They are not getting what it is that they should be getting. They are the ones leading when it comes to literacy level and all of that. In terms of insecurity, they are still the one battling more than every other part of the country. And the narrative continues to be that the North is the one benefiting from the structure. Is it truly that of the elite in the North benefiting from what we have, and that of the South benefiting from what we have, or that the entire North and the entire South are really the ones benefiting from what we have
Oligaki.
thank you for that question. I'm happy, and I'm sure Ustaz knows a lot about it. We also said it. That's where education, you see, that's why I talk about people who want to kill themselves for or with these politicians, either from the North, from the East, or from the West. They are one. That's the truth. I've wine and dined with them as a journalist. I've been an insider into so many things with them. Now, education, for instance, while it is both an advantage and disadvantage to us in the South, mark my words, an advantage and a disadvantage to us in the South, it is an advantage to the elite in the North. That's why the elite in the North will continue to have a lot of the people there uneducated. Because that's one very strong instrument they are using. In fact, that's one thing they are using to keep the so-called unity in the North. Honestly, statistically, we look at it, they've had taste of power, federal power.
More than us.
But believe it. Poverty, of course, statistics have shown it. Underdevelopment is more prevalent
reality
in the North, the reality, than us here. So that's why education to the elite, they don't want it because it's an advantage. And that's the disadvantage to us, because we are quick to agitate. We are quick to come out with vexation, because we all have an idea about the way we want it. We have a dream. A lot of them do not have the dream. It's easy for a man to have 16 wives in the north, and he will just control the 16 of them. None of them will say, I want to work. I want to make money for myself. I wonder how many people will still hold on to that in the south. You can have 16 wives, but I wonder if you'll be able to keep all the 16 from not doing wussy-wussy business. It is still possible for them to have 30 children and none will go to school. And it's not bothered. The mothers are not bothered. I wonder if that will happen in the south. If the father himself is not bothered, the mother will be bothered at least one of my child.
Even the children.
His neighbor wouldn't allow that.
Do you understand?
They will shout at him.
That's why I said, I've worked there. I've lived there. You understand? So they are suffering more than us. I wonder how many of us will be radicalized here and say, be paid to go and commit when you kill yourself.
Suicide bombing.
I wonder how many of us. We can have a few. But I wonder if anywhere in the south, particularly the southwest, will permit itself for bandits to dominate and domicile there and be operating without doing something on our own, without not waiting for government. So that's the problem a lot of us in that are not seeing. So that's why, from where I started, I love us to place this argument on the facts and what will unite us. We are better as a Nigerian. My people, the media are not telling us that even from the VAT, federal government is only retaining 15% of it. 85% is shared. But they make it look as who? They just say they give it to Kano. Yeah, there are moral issues. I've talked about those are issues we should be exposing.
Yeah, well, I don't know. In addition to what he has said, I remember that I've said this severally, here on this platform, that what is happening in the north is what I want to call war of attrition. And that the behemoth that they created, the monster that they created, is now fighting back in the north. I said this severally. When SLS came up, Sanusi Lamido Sanusi, and was painting the picture of this thing needs to change, the powers that be, because they are benefiting from that, said no. When he said no, we can't keep on marrying wives, and you marry, say, I divorce you, and that is the end of it. Nobody takes care of such woman. The person goes ahead to marry another person. Was like, no, we shouldn't do this. It is not working. Nobody listened to him. The current problem we have in the Northeast, look, they are the ones suffering. When we talk of all these banditry, etc., the people in the North are the worst hit. When Lake Chad was receding, and international community were screaming and shouting that Lake Chad is receding. And that Lake Chad is the economic sustainer, the baseline, the basis of economic survival of the people of the Northeast. Nigeria, we're not listening. Now, they became easy recruits for bandits. With 5,000 naira, somebody is ready to go and die. We've seen it happening. Governor Zulum came out and was telling us.
So now, the federalism we're talking about, the true federalism that we aspire to have in Nigeria, is it going to take care of that aspect where the regions would definitely look after the people of the regions?
Do you know what's going to take care of it? I'm sorry, let me just cut in. Even this VAT issue, a number of northern governors have started telling themselves that, look, we're not doing it, we're not looking inward. We have a lot of things that could make us to be rich. Look, for God's sake, I have been saying, our governor in the Southwest, I was on this part, I said it. Federal government is not taking revenue from agricultural products. So if you add cocoa and you sell cocoa into England or London or wherever, and you have foreign exchange earning,
So the federal government is not saying, come and give us out of it. I don't know that you are getting that. Mm-hmm. So they too equally have such potentialities, such things that they could really invest, you know, themselves into, and their population, and their mass, you know, land that they have there, which they're not looking inward because of what is coming from this, from the center. So what we need to do is simple. Some of these things will force them to start doing the right thing. I want to be sure. When some of this, you know, restructuring start coming up, you will see that they will sit tight. A lot of things will start happening, and you're like, you start asking questions. Are you saying this thing can happen in Nigeria? Yes. So the people of the north, those that are sensible, wise among them, intelligent, are beginning to tell them, we need to look inward. This is affecting us more than other part of Nigeria. One day, what we are looking for, even if they discover oil in the north, I've asked a question. How would they manage it? How would they transport it? We saw what is happening in South Sudan and North, I mean, Sudan and Southern North Sudan. We see what is happening there. So the same thing will eventually happen. So they too cannot afford to say they want to tear Nigeria apart. They just need to look inward and develop their human resources. And plenty of that is available in the north.
Okay, so it means, as we're closing, you know, right and left or center, the VAT controversy is really opening Pandora box, as bringing out so many questions for development and for Nigeria's true federality to grow, if in the long run, I'm trying to avoid the word battle. If the legal battle is actually won by the states, isn't it, Mr. Ayodele, as we close?
No, honestly, at the end of it, that's why, again, I go to my constituency. Those are the kind of things we should be exposing, that Ekiti, you can survive. Sokoto, you will survive. Kogi, there are so many things.
Jigawa.
You understand? Those are the areas where there are the positives of this. Well, instead, we are just opening the morality. Kano is not there. They don't drink beer there. They are collecting money. You understand? That's what I'm saying. At the end of it, I'm sure the legal battle will give us more positivity.
We want to thank you so much, gentlemen, for coming this morning. It's been a very, very exciting and educative session we've had with the two gentlemen here, and you can't actually expect less, because these are two of the very cerebral analysts we have in town, in Ogun State. Mr. Jibril Lawa, thank you so much for coming.
It's a pleasure, it's a being pleasure here
to have you. And Mr. Dede Ayodele, thank you so much too.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll take this break. When we return, we'll be talking about recipe for lasting global peace. Stay with us.
Fellow Nigerians, do you know that constituency projects are actually your projects? Do you know that constituency projects are funded by the federal government? Do you know that you can track release of constituency project funds for projects located in your constituency and follow up to know how they have been executed? Constituency projects happen because government does not want to leave any community out in development efforts. You have a responsibility to know what constituency project has been planned for your community, how much has been allocated for it, and whether value for money has been delivered. Take ownership of constituency projects located in your community. Protect them because they belong to you. Government knows about your needs and is planning for you. Government needs your help to ensure quality delivery. Know that constituency projects are actually your projects. Protect your constituency project. My constituency, my project.
For information on funds allocated to projects in your constituency, call 0800-2255-4272.
This message is from the Independent Corrupt Practices and Other Related Offenses Commission and the National Orientation Agency.
Chief, good morning, sir. You are here already?
No. Now my spirit day, my body day for house. What kind of question is that? Were you not the one that fixed this meeting for 8 a.m.? You are now coming by 10 a.m. and start asking me jam question.
My bad chief now. I'm sorry. Don't you also go late for meeting sometimes? You know now, African time thing.
No more African time. And no more pancaking of face during office hours. At the end of the day, we will lose valuable time. We will not make progress. If we want to move this nation forward, we must treat business as business and respect time. Change begins with me.
Thank you, sir. I am sorry. Can we go for the meeting now, Chief?
Better.
This message is brought to you by the National Orientation Agency in conjunction with the Federal Ministry of Information and Culture.
There are some mischief makers who are in the habit of peddling fake news on the internet while also encouraging others to further spread these unfounded information. Fake news can lead to tension, apprehension, create fear amongst the populace, and mislead others. Before you post or share any information on social media, verify the information. It is our responsibility to stop the spread of fake news.
I am a responsible student.
And I respect the values of my community.
I work and study hard so I can make my family, community, and Ogun State proud.
I will not promote any act that will show myself, my family, and Ogun State in bad light.
I reject any group which promotes killings, gangsterism, and is inimical to my aims and objectives as a student.
I have a lot of people looking up to me, my family, siblings, and community. They are all hoping I get good grades, graduate, get a good job, and make them proud.
Becoming a cultist will terminate this dream and bring shame to these people depending on me.
I will not allow my life and dreams to be cut short and make my loved ones cry over me.
The day you join can be the day you will die.
Sean Cortesy.
Say no to Cortesy.
Don't live in fear. Don't give in to peer pressure. Seek counsel. This message is from the Ogun State Government.
Well, there's never a time you can't talk peace. Peace is important and a lasting one for that matter, for the world, for any society to grow. Tomorrow is World Peace Day, but here on the program this morning, we want to quickly talk about it. It doesn't really matter if it's tomorrow, because tomorrow too, we'll still talk about it. Peace is something that we have to talk about every day of our lives. We have in the studio joining us this morning to look at a recipe for lasting global peace. Can we really have global peace? Can we say achievable? These are the issues that we'll look at in the next 25 minutes. We have Mr. Lekan Ketokun. He's a peace and conflict studies scholar. He's joining us this morning. Good morning, Mr. Ketokun.
My pleasure. Good morning.
To see you. Thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
This is one area you've been involved in for quite some time. And but the body language of the world doesn't look like we are likely to actually have a world that is permanently peaceful.
Well, thank you very much. We always hope for peace because the nature of the world itself, being a world that involves human beings, and who by their nature or by our nature. We are very, very unpredictable. The values we hold differs from one another. The language we speak differs from one another. And there are so many things that we don't share in common. And because we don't share things in common, there is that tendency that you have disagreement, that you have crisis and conflict. But what the world is doing, by way of the United Nations and some other bodies like ours, is to ensure, is to begin to look at ways where we can reduce the events of conflict and violence in the world.
And so, tomorrow, this day, World Peace Day is going to be celebrated.
Yeah.
what are the issues or the points of discussion tomorrow globally?
Well, anyway, the theme for this year's World Peace Day is recovering for an equitable and sustainable world. And the theme is one theme that has been given by the United Nations. Every year, the United Nations comes out with a theme for the celebration of World Peace Day on September 21. Now, for this year, the theme is recovering for an equitable and sustainable world. You know, we are just recovering from COVID. And the idea is that we want to help everybody to get better, to recover from the devastation of COVID, and to create a more sustainable and equal world for everybody. So that is the idea of this world, this year's theme.
Okay, talking about the theme and talking about our challenges in Nigeria, especially in this part of Nigeria, we oftentimes would hear, you know, people want to go about their businesses and they are being obstructed based on other people's belief as to, and which of course is a cause of conflict, and of course not just conflict, but the violent ones that people would have to die, and of course a reprisal will have to take place and all that. So contextualizing the theme for this year's celebration of the World Peace Day, how do you think we can manage that successfully in this part of the world?
Well, the whole idea of the theme for this year is about how to achieve a sustainable peace, really. And if you look at the theme itself, it stresses that we want a world that will be more equitable, more just, and to ensure that everybody is able to do his or her own thing without any encumbrance from any quarters. And so that is the idea. In Nigeria, you know, and globally, conflict is somehow today endemic. You talk about Afghanistan, you talk about Syria, you talk about the Middle East. Even in Nigeria here, we have the Boko Haram issue and the Heather's Farmers crisis and all those kind of crises. You see, the more you look, it's like you have more crisis than peace. But what the world is doing, because conflict is part and parcel of every society. You cannot do without conflict. Conflict can be positive, it can be negative. So what we try to do is to emphasize the positive aspect of conflict so that the world could become better. You don't want to keep on emphasizing the negative aspects of conflict. And that's what the United Nations is all about, is for the promotion of peace and security in the world. And so every year, what we do is to come out with actions and policies that promote peace in spite of the differences that abound in the world. In spite of the various conflicts, we still try as much as possible to ensure that everything we do is about how to bring about peace and sustainable peace.
Okay, let's also look at the issue of conflict. Conflict is one thing that a lot of people believe that conflict should not be, and because people are of different nature, they want to do things, so there is no way. The peace scholars will say that there is no way we can avoid conflicts. Like you said, the positive and the negative. So when you look around, especially in our country, you look at politicians, you look at the basic things that actually come to lead to conflict, and of course the ones that lead to violence, largely people will say that the standard of living of the people, it has to be improved upon, even though you believe that the conflict is not something that should continue, that we should have. So if the world, that's the UN, is talking and trying to make effort at getting to a point where conflict is reduced, maybe violent conflict is reduced in the world of today. So what is it that really speaks directly to the root causes of conflict in your own view?
Well, when you talk about conflict, I've said it before, conflict is something that occurs when there are incompatible goals to achieve. And for example, even within the family, when the husband and the wife have issues that border on incompatibility, that would always be conflict and crisis in that marriage. And when you now take that to the national or global level, different countries of the world fight over resources, for example. And when you fight over resources, you fight over values. These are things that bring about conflict. And the resource-based conflicts are easy to resolve because it involves resources. But the value ones, the value-based conflicts are the ones that are turning, creating a lot of crisis in the world, because that is very difficult to resolve. The issue of the Niger Delta, for example, is a resource-based conflict, and you can always put certain things in place to resolve that, and that's why you don't have much crisis in the Niger Delta. But the ones that are based on values
and doctrines,
yes, ideology and things like that, those are the ones that are causing a lot of crisis in the world. That's why you have the Al-Qaeda, the Al-Shabaab, and Boko Haram, and the Taliban in Afghanistan, all over the world. And these are the ones that are really, really causing the major devastation in the world. And because of that, a lot of things have been put in place by the world body. You have the instrumentality of the Security Service, the Security Council of the United Nations, for example, trying to do a lot of things. And you have five permanent members, of course, who have also their own allies and supporters and things like that. And then you have some other countries joining them. All these are ways and means of ensuring that the world is a peaceful place. But of course, like I've said, you cannot have a purely conflict-free society anyway. It's like an utopia, because as long as you have misunderstanding, as long as you have differences, as long as you have people who want to hold on to their views without allowing others to have a say, you will always have conflict. But what we do as peace practitioners is to look at non-violent ways of resolving this conflict, because we have seen that violent ways of resolving conflict is never works. For example, look at the issue of the Boko Haram. We have been adopting the military strategy all along, and the military strategy has not worked all along. And even when we had that resource-based conflict in the Niger Delta, when it was just the military action, it didn't work until President Yar'Adua came and then offered an olive branch to the militants in the Niger Delta, and then they had to shelve their militancy and they embrace peace. So what I'm trying to say is that we must continue to engage ourselves and look for ways of reducing these serious conflicts in the world.
Well, we will continue to have platforms like these to discuss conflict issues, how we can actually achieve peace globally.
Yeah.
Even in the academia,
yeah.
You know, peace is an issue.
Yeah.
And even in government circle. But how possible can the world achieve a lasting peace or lasting peace if the real players in government are not singing themes of peace? There are two coup d'etats in Africa as we speak. We also spoke about Afghanistan. So many leaders of the world are doing things that are looking, you know, that are tilting towards violent conflicts and all of that. So is it achievable? Can we ever achieve peace in the world with the way things are going almost on a daily basis? You know, we have issues and issues across all continents of the world.
Well, I've said it before, achieving peace, lasting peace or sustainable peace is a goal to be worked on. But in practical terms, you cannot have total peace, as it were. because by the definition of peace itself, the absence of all forms of psychological, physical,
structural
violence, and
the presence of justice,
That is very difficult.